Alright folks, Eternal Angler. So today we'll be doing an unboxing of the new underwater drone I recently received in the mail, the Fifish V6 Expert. Really excited about this underwater drone. Can't wait to use it. Been hearing nothing but positive things about it. You know, it's kind of an upgrade from the V6S going to the V6 Expert. And I've been hearing nothing but good things, like how they've smoothed out the algorithm to make it a lot more stable navigating around, and I'll kind of get into that later. But there's certain things and features and add-on accessories that separate this underwater drone from the other brands of underwater drones, such as Chasing Innovations M2. You got the Mini S over here. But comparing that drone to M2, these are probably the underwater drones that are a good comparison. They're in the specific price category that you can compare the two. Very relative. They both have claws, but I noticed, you know, QIC is very innovative. They're coming out with certain accessories that Chasing doesn't have, and this just recently got a metal detector, so that's pretty neat. But enough talk. I can keep going on and on about the features of these underwater drones, but let's just get to the unboxing and go from there. Pretty cool. I really like the logo of the Fifish. You know, I just like calling these underwater drones, but as you can see here, they call it an underwater robot. There's the old school terminology that you call it ROV, you know, underwater ROV. But there's, you know, use whatever terminology you feel comfortable with. But I still just like calling these underwater drones. Simple, got a nice ring to it. And what do you know, right when you open the package, you get the manual. And that's basically how it should be. A lot of these, I would say, new hobbyists, new enthusiasts, you kind of want to go over the manual right off the bat. This is a very expensive electronic. I wouldn't compare it to even like an RC car or an RC boat. You need to go over the manual, read the specs, read the directions, how to charge it, how to use it, one of the recommendations, the maintenance and all that. I'm pretty experienced with underwater drones, so, you know, I don't really have to go over the manual as much. So we're gonna toss it aside, but I just wanna highly recommend reading that over, and it's nice that the company basically, you know, has that right on top of the box so you can read it. But anyways, let's set this down here. It comes in a styrofoam box, as you can see here. This is how my Chasing M2 came. And honestly, I ended up throwing that styrofoam case away. It wasn't really great that great for transporting it, but if you don't have anything, something like this might work pretty well. But let's turn it around that way you can actually read the logo, because it's kind of cool. The logo sticks out on it. It's a nice looking case. But honestly, when transporting these underwater drones, I highly recommend using a foldable wagon. You know, I bought like even an extended foldable wagon I talked about in a recent review. That's what I put my Lakewood Monster tackle box in. So I could basically carry all my underwater drones, whatever park or lake I go to, and it makes it easy for transportation. You know, the cases that they sell on like QIC or even Chasing Innovations, they're super expensive, like $500. That a foldable wagon was $100. But anyways, let's open this up and see what's inside, see what goodies they have for us. Pretty exciting. Looks pretty sharp, man. You know, big change is the color. You know, when the Fifish V6 came out, it was in fluorescent yellowish green. Kind of similar to some of the colors you've seen in fishing. You know, people use a lot of soft plastics were in that color. But it had a nice highlight color to it. And I suspect the reason they use that is so you can see it when it surfaces, you can see it in murky water. Easy to, you know, get down and grab it out of the murky water, or so other boaters navigating around could see it so they don't run it over or run over the tether. But they've gone from that highlighted fluorescent color to like a more stealthy look, more like metallic charcoal color. It's kind of similar color in my Hellcat, so it blends in nicely. I'll have to take a photo of these two together just because the color is very similar and I really like it. It might be stealthier for navigating around underwater, and the fish might not pick it up on it as much either, but I like the way it looks, pretty sharp. Going on to other things we have in here in the box, got the power cable down below. I think this is a charger for the controller. You got the FPV goggles right here, like they're kind of virtual reality like, and then you have the manual tether reel right here. And what's nice about QIC is this, all these like five fishes, whatever model you buy, they always come with this like manual reel for the tether, and it just better way to keep you organized. When I bought my Chasing M2, it didn't come with the reel, so I got to use my hands all the time to take up the slack. I haven't gotten around to buying a reel for it. And they also do have like an automated reel for the Chasing M2, but what kind of sucks, I think, for the V6 Expert is I don't think they have an automated reel. I think they do, but it's for the W6, but it's like $2,000 or $3,000, and I can post a photo of that up here. But anyways, we can take the reel out of the box, show you guys what this looks like. They've been using the same design for even the base model V6 when it first came out, and it's simple. It's not really that heavy duty, but hey man, it's a better way to keep your tether organized than rather what I've been dealing with lately. So getting past that reel, getting to the FPV goggles, another thing that kind of sets this underwater drone apart from other underwater drones is it comes with these like FPV goggles. They're like virtual reality like, so you can basically, of course, cut out the sun, you put these on, but you slip in your phone, and when you move your head up, the underwater drone moves with it. When you move down, the underwater drone moves down. You go left or right, it also goes left or right. So that's pretty cool. I think, like I said, I'm starting to see that QIC is like the leaders in innovation, man. They're doing some really cool things that a lot of other underwater drones aren't doing. But I'll say this about the safety of having like your cell phone up to your head for long periods of time. The verdict's not out on that yet. You know, you had the Chicago Tribune study that just recently came out about some of the radiation on even the iPhones being higher than what they should be at. And there's this Dr. Nandy that went on Channel 7 News and talked about this, that he recommends limiting your use of cell phone up to your head because of radiation. So I'm still kind of weary about this, having a cell phone in FPV goggles and wearing it for long periods of time. I'll post a video link of that Channel 7 News episode, and you know, it's up to you guys, but I just want to recommend that. I talked about it on my underwater drone forum, and I still prefer using the Hoodman Aviator Hav 2. This blocks out all the sun. It's easy to navigate on my iPad. It's just very simple, and it's just still very virtual reality-like, and I really like it. But if you want to try this out, you know, you're all for it. I probably will give it a try, see what it's like navigating around with your head movement. It sounds pretty cool. But anyways, getting past that, so taking the controller out, comparing it to the controller on the Chasing M2, very similar designs. Get this foam out of the way. Very similar designs. You basically have a foam holder, or a foam, or I'm sorry, an iPad holder. It expands. I know I gotta use a little more strength in the Chasing M2. Both similar for that reason. It has these springy holders down below, and also the Chasing M2 has the same thing. But it seems like the plastic on the controller, the Fifish, is a lot stronger. This is a little flimsy on the Chasing M2, but not that much noticeably different. I really like the ergonomics on the Fifish a little better. It just seems a little more comfort, a little more intuitive on this remote. And then just picking up the chasing M2, this is like square. This reminds me of Xbox 360 controller, and I love that controller, and it was super ergonomic. I could play video games for hours on end. It just feels like I could control an underwater drone for a long period of time and not have any, like, you know, any type of uncomfort problems using this controller. But taking a quick look at them, pretty similar, man. And the one's also white, the other one's yellow. It's kind of interesting that they didn't try to match the color of the Expert, but it is what it is. And then the first thing I noticed, it has two dials. The chasing M2 still has two dials, but what I'm getting at is, originally using the claw on the chasing M2, you just had to press this button down, control it that way, and, you know, press it down, claw would open. In order to go reverse, close it, I think you had to tap it twice or something. It was just a pain in the ass, but I think Fifish right off the bat was using the dial to open and close the claw, and that's nice. It's just a lot more precise. That's what chasing should have been doing from the get-go. But yeah, I really like the feel. I gotta see what these buttons are. I have no clue. This clicky up top here is like, you got off, channel one, channel two, and then there's channel ASC. So I'm sure, like, people that are familiar with RC cars and boats probably know what that stuff is about. But also, what's interesting, it's got these rubber seals around the joysticks. And this is, like, a little different. You know, you don't have that on the Chasing M2 controller. And it's just the plastic's exposed. So what I'm getting at is they did this, I suspect, to protect from possibly rain, any type of water getting on this controller and getting inside of the electronics. Kind of nice, but this stuff is super thin. I don't know if it's gonna last, but anyways, that's pretty much all I have to say about the controller. I mean, and also has this bracket back here so you can carry it around. Super nice looking, set it down, and a bracket, I guess, gives it a little more stand up. I guess you could, like, could you still control it kind of, since it has a bracket down there and you set it on the ground, can you still control it a little bit? Maybe it's for that reason too, but I think it's mainly for carrying it around. But bringing up the actual underwater drone itself so you get a good look at it, like, we're going to compare, like, just the whole body design to the Chasing M2. Kind of looks like a flying saucer, some people call it UAPs now. It really does. It looks like a very hydrodynamic design compared to, like, the square brick bulky frame of the Chasing M2. And that, like I talked about in a recent review of that video, I was worried about how stable this underwater drone would be moving through the water because of the shape of it. And you also have the Gladius Mini S, which is a lot more hydrodynamic and smoother looking, but it's a lot more narrower. They're both similar size, but the Mini S is, like, a lot more narrower than both of these underwater drones. And, you know, I came across one of my subscribers over at Metro Park recently, Lake St. Clair, and he goes, you know, he got to see the M2 in person while I was taking it out. And he goes, yeah, it looks a lot bigger in person. You can never really, if you're new to this hobby, you can really never just go by the way they look in the video. They're a lot bigger. And I have to say, the V6 Expert is a lot heavier than what it looks. It looks, some people were saying in the Facebook group, this is more like a toy drone, and this is, like, more, I guess you could say, heavier duty. But I'm telling you, this seems pretty heavy duty to me, you know? People have their own bias, they have their own opinions. It's just the same thing with sports cars. Certain people like certain brands over others, just like Xbox, PlayStation. So people are gonna have their favorites, so remember that. One of the reasons I wanted to get this drone is not only for some of the features that sets it apart from the M2, but I run this, I'm an administrator of this forum called underwaterdroneforum.com. And I just, these tend to be the top companies right now. That may change with time, but right now they're the two top companies seem to be going head to head in a battle. And I just felt like I had to get this underwater drone so I have a less bias and just kind of, you know, have a variety of videos. And it's gonna be nice since this is a metal detector. I wonder if I can get out with a friend. I can use the metal detector, he can use the claw, and we can try to like do some treasure hunting and see what we can find. Maybe some old coins, maybe some old Ray-Bans from the 80s. You just never know what you're gonna find with these underwater drones. But anyways, getting past that, you know, just looking at the design of them, again, this is like a closed shell design. This is a open cage or open shell design. I think this is gonna be a lot easier for modifying, especially working on. I talked about on a recent review the chasing M2. But however, I'll say this, you know, I talked about how it's easy to take the thrusters off and even just unscrew them, the wire here. I think it's somewhat similar, even though this is a closed shell design. I think you have three screws right here and then three screws on the bottom, and then you can like kind of somewhat work on the motors or oil them up. If you gotta like take one of those picks and pull out some of the fishing line. Remind you, they did recently come out with some thruster covers for these to prevent things like rope or fishing line getting caught up, even seaweed. I don't know, here's another important thing. I don't know if they have upgraded the plastic material on these propellers, because I've seen this post in the Facebook groups, and I posted multiple times in my underwater drone forum that they use a really soft plastic material for the propellers. And just going through weeds, people had two or three expeditions and those propellers were getting all chewed up, man. Completely chewed up. So hopefully with this new model, they toughened up the plastic. I'm not sure if it did, but you might want to get those thruster covers right off the bat so you don't have to really worry about that too much. But I also heard with the thruster covers that you lose some of the power, like some of the force of these thrusters, so you lose some of the push. But that might not be a big deal. But other than that, I think this is a smoother design. This platform has been out a lot longer than the Chasing M2. You know, they got the M2 Pro now, the M2 Pro Max. This has, the next step up is the V6 Plus. They've also had, of course, like I said, the V6S, and also the Fifish V6. It's just this platform has been up a lot longer, and I'm not surprised. It's starting to look like, going by what other YouTubers are saying, that this is a lot more stable than this when filming or navigating or using the claw. And I still think the design of this is probably gonna be smoother. And you know, this has six thrusters, this has eight thrusters. A lot different, man, a lot different design. This might take a little more time to get the algorithm down to steady it out since you have two more thrusters. This seems like just six thrusters is the way to go. And it just, this has some crazy maneuverability. It's just like they're doing like dogfighting underwater. I mean, some of the maneuverability, you're really not going to use it for filming much from my point of view. It just seems like if you're avoiding like torpedoes underwater, that'll be what it's good for. But we're doing that. It just seems like it has crazy maneuver. It like does like rolls in the water, it goes around things. It's just pretty wild. Even though it has six thrusters, it can do, seems like, more omni movement than the Chasing M2, so that's kind of interesting. But what else did I want to talk about the design? I think we're getting down to the specs. You know, before getting down to the specs, I do want to say you got to go on World War II History Hunter's channel. In one of his first videos he put out, he talked about going from the V6S to using this, the V6 Expert. And you know what he said? He said, this is a lot smoother, man. Navigating around, and when he put the claw on, it just seems a lot more precise. And he could notice it quite a bit.
Wow, look at that. It moves very smoothly, very, very smoothly. QIC has worked so much with the software and the stability and I can't wait to see how that panned out.
I'm gonna be very honest right off the bat here and say this feels so much more stabilized. It's amazing. You can see in the center. Let me take you through this and let you see what's going on here.
I'll have to say another thing about this design, and I made this quite apparent that I didn't like at the Chasing M2. It was one of the most negative things I didn't like about it was this cheap plastic bracket back here. When you hook up the tether to the standard port here to power up the underwater drone, and you put the loop back here in this little plastic bracket, when you grabbing stuff that are possibly snagged on the bottom or heavy, you gotta reel up the tether. It's putting a lot of weight and pressure back on this bracket that could easily snap. I was able to, look what's in over there, pull up that aerial drone, but that was light. World War II history on her was able to pull up like an old World War II ammo box up by, the tether hooks up and back here, and then the loop goes around over this thick handle. And he was able to, he doesn't seem like a really strong dude, but with time he was able to pull that, the ammo box up, and it's hard to grabbing the tether. It's, you don't have a lot of leverage, especially if you're not a super strong guy, but he was able to do it. And I thought that was absolutely wild. I was very impressed. And they have a photo of this down in a pool. What was the V6S? It's the same, same design, same material basically. And they were actually pulling up like heavy duty kettlebells from the bottom of the pool and having the tether wrapped around this thick handle here, pulling it up. It goes to show, I think the design of this, for that reason, for picking up heavy items when you're treasure hunting with the claw, is a lot better than just chasing them too. But like I said, I think an aftermarket company will make some metal bracket back here that can attach the cage. Chasing has already made like a metal bracket and a metal clip for the M2 Pro Max. So they're improving on those things. But again, when I'm like out treasure hunting and I find something heavy, I'll probably go to this for picking up more heavy items off the bottom. Something to think about, especially if you're just using this mainly for treasure hunting. But I'll say this, when it comes to like visuals, filming fish, and you're in freshwater where it's murky, talking about the apertures, this can be important. This actually has a 2.5 aperture. This has a 1.8 aperture, and they say the lower aperture it is, the more that that basically that lens and the light gets into that sensor, it opens up further. Again, lower the aperture, the more light you get in, that lens is opened up. So if you're concentrating on more filming the best quality footage, video footage underwater in murky water conditions, especially for freshwater, you might want to go with this. But then again, here's the thing, getting down to using these underwater drones at night or even murky water conditions, they made an upgrade from the V6S. The V6S used to have 4,000 lumens lights. These are now 6,000 lumens. If you notice, comparing where the LED lights are to the Chasing M2, they're more separated from the camera. And this might be better for picking up less water particles, and they're also pushed back a little bit. And I'll post this video up here. It just popped up in my YouTube feed the other day and I was watching it. There's two dudes, these guys had two Fifish V6 experts, and they're following each other one around. The one dude has his claw, the other one isn't equipped with claw. It seems like the one's treasure hunting, the other one's scouting, navigating around to find objects, and then they're communicating with one another. Yeah, follow me around. It's just cool. But it was kind of, I don't know if it was nightfall out, but it was, they were down deep and it was very dark. And I noticed these LED lights came in really handy, and it seemed like they're picking up less water particles. And then there's this, also this other video of these guys in a cave and like some type of mine, and they sent the expert down, and I also seemed to be picking up less water particles. Now they have come out with like extension arms for the Chasing M2, but it just, they seem cheap. They make, you know, they're a lot wider and the tether can wrap around those arms. But anyway, stock for stock, I think the LED lights are better on the Expert. So if you can use this at night, murky water condition, even though this has a better aperture, might be better visual. Well, this might shine with better LED lighting. So, there's just so much to talk about, and you really have to look at the specs yourself. I mean, I'm trying to go over these things, I do not want to make like turn this into a review. This is mainly just unboxing. I haven't even used this yet. I'm going by what other people say. Remember that. I'm just going by the specs. When I put both these underwater drones down in the water, maybe this one will have somehow better visuals. This supposedly has the same specs as this, like the same sensor, same aperture, but some reason I noticed the M2 for some reason tends to have better visuals in murky water. Maybe it has to do with the lens. I don't know. So, you know, sometimes looking at the specs, they look better, but then you put it down. Now, I will say this, I've heard they upgraded the battery power, the battery capacity on the Fifish V6 Expert, going from the V6S. I can't remember what the V6S was rated at and what the Expert is now, but I just know they've upgraded, so look into it. But I don't really concentrate on those things too much. I did because I want a replaceable battery, but it just, these companies tend to put out figures is what I'm getting at, and it just, they're not always reliable figures. You really got to get out and use it yourself, and that's what you're going to go on, because there's times where, you know, you're using it at full power mode and they might drain quicker. You're using the claw with the underwater drone that drains power even more. Just something to think about. And if you're worried about that, you can always get a power bank, and the power bank connects to the tether, and then you can get out full day's worth. But what's really changed for the V6 Expert, they now have this port, SD card port right here. And I have to say, the metal they use compared to the M2, it's just like beefier, it seems like it's stronger, and it's a lot better quality stainless steel metal. But this is basically where you put the, change out the SD card, and that's different. You know, the Fifish V6S didn't have that. That's pretty impressive. And now they, getting back to the thrusters, they do have these Q motors. They're supposed to be more sealed off now. But I've heard like similar thing they did with the chasing M2. Without a doubt, you get down to the bottom, sand's probably gonna still get in there. There's still gonna be maintenance to these motors. I still highly recommend, like I recommended in the chasing M2 review video, to use some type of lubricant every so often. Some people, when they use it in salt water, they almost use it every day. But I noticed there's not much space here to get that lubricant into the thrusters. Supposedly they're sealed off now. They're doing everything they can to extend the life of these underwater drones, but they have fishing reels that they've sealed off, and there's still maintenance to them. They have outboard motors that are still sealed off, and there's still maintenance to them, especially in salt water. Just that shit's so corrosive. When I was done fishing the surf down in Florida, I started noticing, like, lubricate that reel up every 2 to 3 expeditions. I mean, just, it was that bad. And I still think, even though these Q motors are sealed off and it's like patent pending, their new design they're using, there's still gonna be maintenance. You gotta run this in the tub afterwards, probably for like 15 minutes, salt water probably even longer, and I still think you'll have to lubricate it. And that's just my opinion. And they got this new Q-Steady 2.0. And at first when I saw that, is this like similar to the digital EIS stabilization that they're using for the camera, and it's like wavy and all distorted to like basically improve the stabilization look of the camera and the video footage? No, it's not. That's digital. I think the Q-Steady is basically part of the software algorithm that they worked on with these 6 thrusters, and they're able to stabilize this drone very well. Like I said, check out the World War II history hunter, what he said, how stable this drone is. I think it might be now the most stable underwater drone on the market. I know Dustin Dunhill was making some positive comments about the Navatex Mito, but that only has like, I think like four thrusters on it, and it can't go like 90 degree angles, can't go lateral movement. This has omni movement, and it can do all that, and rolls, all types of crazy shit, and that comes in so handy when you're using the claw. So, you know, and then another thing that I've been really focused on carrying it to the M2, this doesn't have like any type of posture lock. So if there's current, any type of turbulence, you kind of get near the mouth of the river, this has posture lock. So you can lock up at a certain precise area in the water column, and when, you know, turbulence or current hits you, it should lock you in place. It also has a new thing called focus lock, or I think it's vision lock. There's kind of similar but two separate things, but from my understanding, like vision lock is where you basically lock on like some type of coral, an anchor, something you see, and you kind of can circle around it. And I wonder if you can do that with fish, like lock on a fish and it just automated and follows it around for you. I think you can't do that yet, but with time, I think QIC, that's a big breakthrough they've recently done with this software update with vision lock and focus lock, and I can't wait to see where they go from there with, you know, their advances in software. And just, this is a very innovative company. They're doing some impressive things. Another thing, like I said, they have the metal detector out for it. They have all types of different claws coming out for it. They have like a fishing net so you can scoop things up. They had like a water sampler. Considering like some of the pollution problems we're having over at Kent Lake, it makes you wonder if you can go over there, test the water for impurities. It just, the accessories and add-ons are just endless that QIC is coming out with. The one thing that I'm really focusing on is sonar, but it's just the pricing isn't there yet. It's not that affordable, so I'm kind of disappointed in that, but what are you going to do? It's expensive. Like I said in my review, there is a company, I think it's Blue Robotics, that has a cheaper sonar, but I don't know if it's going to be compatible with their software. So, but pretty impressive with all the accessories they're coming out with. We're almost, and I'm about to wrap it up here with this unboxing, but comparing the two, I'm bringing out the claw right now as we speak. This is like one of the most impressive things that I like with an underwater drone. I really enjoy treasure hunting. I enjoy picking up things off the bottom. But there is actually quite a bit of difference between these claws. This is a little more bulkier, but it's still somewhat pretty lightweight compared to the Chasing M2 claw. And what do you notice here? You have these two tubes in the side. Now the Chasing M2 doesn't have that at all. I suspect this is to help with buoyancy, to help stabilize the underwater drone when you attach this claw onto it. Because I noticed when I had the Genino T1, people were starting to attach like foam onto the claw to balance it out because they have a tough time navigating around picking stuff up. But remind you, the T1 didn't have lateral movement like the M2. So it's not really a good comparison. But again, they did add like foam in to help the buoyancy of this claw. That way when you put it on, it doesn't, you know, loses balance when you're moving around the claw. But you don't seem to have to do that with this, but it seems like Fifish felt that they probably had to have these tubes in here in place to, I guess, to improve the balance. But just to show you where this sits at, you basically put it on like so, and this claw sits a lot further back, as you can see, compared to the Chasing M2, where once you put this on, you'll see how far it sits in front. It's about like right there, I think we put it on. Yep. And look how further the claw sits off. And someone put out a video a year ago, comparing the V6S to the M2, doing rolls and all those different things with the claw attached. And the V6S was doing a similar thing, and this was kind of wobbling around. So I think since this sits further back, it's a lot more compact. I think it's a little more precise, could be a lot more precise than M2. So just something to think about. And here's the thing, they have both, I've seen photos and people complaining on both Facebook groups where these claws have leaked, but this is a new version. So So maybe this one doesn't leak, I'm not sure. But either way, you know, I talked about what I did to help seal this off and extend the life. I used Plasti-Dip. They use this on a lot of electronics, RC cars and boats, especially if you get an RC car out, hits a puddle. Some people will seal out like areas of the motherboard or other electronics, and it works really well. So since some of these claws were leaking, I put Plasti-Dip around the seams. I put Plasti-Dip around the screws, the top of the heads of the screws that were rusting and oxidizing out. I might do this around the seams of this claw. I haven't made the choice yet. There's a seam back here. But this seems like, going back to the metal they're using, QIC, it just seems like it's a lot heavier duty. Like, look at these giant screws up front here. You're actually the grabber claw itself, like the actual claw. It seems just like bulkier and heavier duty. So I think when I posted up, oh, this claw looks bulkier than an M2. That was a positive thing that I was trying to say. But it's still lightweight. And then, like I said, it has these tubes to help balance it out, I think. So I think QIC, they're really doing some impressive things with their underwater drone. I think that basically wraps it up when I wanted to talk about with this unboxing. But you can't go wrong with either of these, man, and you really can't go wrong with the Gladius Mini S, or even like a Fifish V6. If they both work really well, and all I ask for is just to be patient with these underwater drones. They're still like in their infant stage in the consumer market. They're gonna have problems. Yeah, I've heard how like the LED lights have leaked on the V6, you know, the base version. People are complaining about that. Hopefully they kind of improve that, the seals on the Fifish V6 Expert. And like I said, the plastic material they're using in the propellers, hopefully they'll improve those things. They have improved some of these things I've heard on the Fifish V6 Expert. And what's interesting is, if you like have money, you want to like go to like a lot tougher underwater drone, you also have the V6 Plus, and that actually uses metal propellers. And I always thought, like, since these are both on like a similar platform, the same design, why can't you use the metal propellers from the V6 Plus on the V6 Expert? But I suspect if you are gonna like pretend you need replaceable propellers from the company, they'll probably ask for proof of ownership, like a receipt, because I think people are gonna catch on that we need to start having like tougher propellers of some sort, like a tougher plastic, some type of cheaper, lighter metal. I don't know, but we'll see what happens. But it's interesting how it's the same platform in the upgraded version of the Expert to the Plus, and they actually have metal propellers. Why can't you use those on here? Something to think about. But it about wraps up. Really enjoyed this unboxing. Can't wait to get out and use it. Maybe I'll use this for ice fishing. I really enjoyed some appeal and drag videos. He would basically, in one ice fishing hole, put the GoPro down and film, like, you know, his live bait or whatever jig he's using for ice fishing, and like pike would cruise up, bluegill and perch would cruise up, and you get good footage. And like, I tried doing it, what was it, with the Titan, the T1, you know, I put that down one hole and I was jigging in the next hole, and it just wouldn't stabilize. It would just keep drifting off, even though it wasn't, we were in Anchor Bay and it wasn't like near a river, there's still like a little current and it would drift off. And now that, you know, I posture lock, I got this focus lock, I wonder if I can focus on my bait ice fishing and not have to worry about like constantly controlling it. And then when a pike or something cruises up, you know, I can capture on video footage, you know, ice fishing. I mean, it's one of the reasons His video channel really took off, you know, just like some of his underwater drone or underwater footage is very impressive. But that channel was a lot more than that. I mean, he was a great fisherman. I'm talking past tense. He kind of stopped posting, but he is a great fisherman. It would be nice to see more of his videos, but he did some innovative things. And like I talk about how this technology can help grow sports, especially fishing. You're starting to see it's growing treasure hunting with the World War II history hunter. The other guys were like cave hunters looking in mines and they dropped this down. I gotta post that video. there's a lot of other, the one dude, Michael, he treasure hunts, finds like jewelry on the beach, lost treasure in the ocean. I think he's going to be impressed, you know, with the metal detector comes out for the underwater gym, because he uses a metal detector all the time, and he actually has a business that he makes a living doing it from. This will probably expand his business. Shit, man, it might come a point where he might not even have to wear a diving suit anymore, you know. And supposedly getting the diving, I should have mentioned this at the beginning, supposedly this was made by, or you know, made by a Chinese diver. So pretty impressive. Shout out to QIC. I'm glad you know, the diver decided to create this platform, because it seems to be the top underwater drone as we speak right now. And it just, you know, I'm throwing that out there going based on the specs and what I've heard from other YouTubers, but it is really, I was impressed by the footage I've seen. It seems to be the most stable underwater drone. Now, is it the most reliable? I don't know, but I'll say this, you know, a lot of divers, you know, they've been impaired with their hearing. They've basically disabled themselves going down too deep of water, and I've heard this is a great way for some of the disabled divers to basically get back out and enjoy the atmosphere down in the water. Some people really just, they're lured to the ocean, just like how surfers just, you know, part of their zen and part of their enjoying the great outdoors is they got to be close to the ocean. I think there's a lot of divers like that, and a lot of divers that have been disabled, this has helped them get back to what they enjoy, is diving down in the water, seeing sea creatures, fish, what else you might find, I don't know. And it's gonna, like I said, expand a lot of hobbies, but it just kind of new. I'm not surprised that Dogger created something like an underwater drone, but I have seen videos where this has helped disabled divers get back down to the deep and enjoy the atmosphere down there. And, you know, it's pretty cool, man. This technology, like I said in the review, so when I saw that movie, The Abyss, and they had that little underwater ROV called Little Geek, it's like, man, that is so cool. It's like a thought. And I was like, I had to have been like 10 years old when I saw that video or that movie. And I'm like, man, if anything like that ever comes out on the market, I'm going to get all the way into it. I'm going to get into the hobby. It just, and back then, I don't think it had a claw or anything on it. Maybe it did. I can't remember. Did it help fix things? I think it was just basically video recording most of the time. But I was just impressed with it. I'm like, always thought, I'm like, well, will it happen in my lifetime? It has happened in my lifetime. So this is pretty impressive that these underwater drones have hit the consumer market. Some of them are kind of expensive. These are in similar price category. They're not cheap, like around $2,500 to $3,000. Get with the claw, they're even more. But some of these are starting to get equipped that are more reasonable price, like the Gladius Mini S. This is only $1,000, and you can get this equipped with a claw. And then you have like also something affordable, such as the Chasing Nemo. So, you know, it's only $500, and I think kids will really enjoy using an underwater drone. I think it's still kind of like a little cheap, and they're having problems with it, but gotta give these companies time. This stuff's just, again, still in its infant stage. I think with time, these things are gonna improve, and that'll be great for businesses, expanding hobbies, just basically, you know, adults enjoying, but kids will enjoy them too, and give them a chance to get outside, get some vitamin D from the sun, enjoy the weather outside. You know, it's just, people are getting locked up inside too much with playing like video games these days. I think this will be great with this new innovative technology, get kids outdoors more often. So anyways, on that note, thank you, anglers, and for watching Tight Lines, and take care.
My name's Guy. I had a major spinal injury 12 years ago, the result of a scuba diving accident when I was 17, just before my 18th birthday. I woke up in intensive care after a drug-induced two-day coma. I died twice. I had brain damage when I woke up. I didn't really know who I was or where I was. I was a C7 quadriplegic. I have come a long way. In those 12 years, I'm not a quadriplegic anymore. I am an incomplete paraplegic, which is from my waist down. I have a lot of perspective over how far I've come, but I still use a wheelchair and walking stick to get around. Because of the nature of the accident, I can't scuba dive again. That's something I really miss, being able to explore under the water. We know more about space than we know about what's under the water. But now I can actually dive again with this underwater robot, this underwater drone. The independence of being able to get back under there, not just stay with my cousin and people diving, exploring and adventuring, but I can stay longer, I can go deeper. I feel like I'm right there with them. It's really nice to feel that again.